Welcome to the second episode of This Is Not a Drill Live on Organizing Upgrade. I'm really excited to announce that Organizing Upgrade is being joined by the Real News Network in hosting this episode tonight. So I want to welcome Real News viewers and fans. Thanks for joining. On this show, Adam and I talk with left organizers and leaders with boots on the ground to unpack the latest results from the Democratic primary, discuss what organizers should take away from the elections so far, and talk about what's ahead. This episode is going to be pretty different from the last one, since the last few weeks have seen a huge change in the landscape with the coronavirus growing from public health emergency to full-scale pandemic. Organizers have been actively pointing out the ways in which large swaths of the population are going to be dramatically affected in ways that the mainstream media is missing, like lost wages for workers, inability to pay rent or keep up with personal debt, the deplorable state of prisoners in the context of mass incarceration, and more. And of course, the electoral terrain has completely changed from our last show at the end of February. We are gonna dive into the implications of all of this over the next hour, and I'm gonna toss it over to Adam to introduce our guests.
Cool, so many of you got on because you wanna hear from these folks that are joining us tonight. These are great kind of movement leaders out there really on the ground for the elections and primaries right now. I wanna make clear, like, these people we invited are from organizations I'll introduce, but probably speaking just from their personal views and opinions tonight. We said they could speak freely or for their organization, whatever they prefer. So we have Rachel Gilmer of the Dream Defenders, Bernie Sanders endorsing organization. And they were on the ground yesterday in the Florida elections. We'll be talking about that. Marisa Franco from Mijente, also another organization that endorsed Bernie. and was on the ground in Arizona, Texas, and other states around the country in the primary so far. Maurice Mitchell from the Working Families Party and longtime activist. Also, that organization, as you might know, endorsed Elizabeth Warren for president and worked on that campaign, as well as obviously many others, and we'll be reporting back on that. And Natalia Salgado from CPD, Center for Popular Democracy Action, a network of community orgs who endorsed Bernie Sanders in the primary and has been supporting many of the affiliates in their work around the country. So that's our crew, and let's get started.
Great. So I know people are eager to hear from our guests, so let's just dive right in. Rachel Gilmer, the first question is coming to you. You've been working on the ground in Florida, also made a visit to South Carolina. Bernie obviously had a frustrating night in Florida, and you know, Dream Defenders joined with a whole bunch of other groups to try to postpone and delay the primary due to the impact of coronavirus. Can you just help us make sense of the results in Florida last night and also what impact the fallout from the pandemic had? Hey Rachel, we can't hear your audio right now, so we're gonna pivot to our second guest and come back to you to ask you that same question. Adam, let's toss it over to Marisa.
All right, we'll come back to Rachel. Marisa, you also were working on the primaries. I don't know if you were personally in Arizona, but I know Mijente was. Can you just say what was the impact in Arizona and in the any other states that you were working on, but especially Arizona last night, because that was kind of once the pandemic was already hidden.
Yeah, can y'all hear me?
Yeah.
Hello, everybody. Thanks for having me on. I mean, I think that the virus, I think, definitely had an impact. I think that was a big factor. I think there's a lot of confusion. Because it seemed like they were off, people were going to get their ballots mailed. So it was just kind of a mess. And I just think people are, you know, making really hard decisions and facing hard situations when you are not sure if you and your family are going to be okay, whether you're going to be sick or infected, or you're facing losing your job and wondering how you're going to pay your rent. That's going to be a challenge for people. I think another thing that's just also happening that I think tends to happen in the primaries is just like the like media coverage and kind of like the message that this is a done deal and it's kind of inevitable that it's going to be Biden. I think that does have an impact on voters, and particularly like folks who maybe aren't frequent voters in the primary or don't vote in every election. People start to kind of ask themselves, you know, well, does it matter if I vote? I think you will see, though, as we have seen in states after Super Tuesday, Bernie has continued to have success, in particular with Latino voters. You know, he won Latino voters overwhelmingly in California and Nevada, in Latino-heavy counties of Colorado, in Texas. And last night he won in Chicago, Latino voters. So, like, it's a both and, but I think it's obviously a really difficult situation. And I think moving forward, I think the Biden campaign can celebrate winning Arizona, but they are not going to win Arizona in the general without the Latino vote. And so I think it's very critical that they not celebrate too hard the victory here, because whether it is the people... you know, I think that's a real question. I don't think it's a question of people not wanting Trump out, but it's a question of motivation. And so I think that's also an important story that has to be told, whether it's Arizona or any other states that have a heavy Latino population. I think Florida would be an exception to that, and maybe some other places. But by and large, I think that there is a story there in this primary with respect to Latino voters and the legacy of the Obama administration.
Awesome. Thanks, Marisa. And I want to encourage all our guests to hop in at any point if you have something to add. But let me toss it over to Maurice Mitchell. Mo, I'd like you to follow up a bit on that. You know, we did a lot of coverage on Organizing Upgrade around the time that Working Families made its Warren endorsement. And you made the case at the time that it was strategic for all of us to endorse our preferred candidate early and to get right to work. You know, obviously there's a lot of disappointment amongst Warren supporters about the way the election played out, but can you tell us what organizers can take away from your experience in having had a direct relationship with the presidential campaign?
Sounds not working.
Hey, Mo, is there a chance that you're muted?
Am I muted? Can you hear me?
Oh, there you go. Okay, can you start over for me?
Sure. So thanks for having me. It was a lot of technical difficulties here, but I'm happy that we're finally online. So thanks again for having me. And what I was going to say is that from our experience, and we're still processing that, because that was, you know, I mean, I know a few weeks ago feels like an entire year, given everything that took place in that short period of time. But one of the takeaways was our ability to engage with the Warren campaign around the substance of policy, around a posture of collaboration and accountability. And, you know, we think that there were a number of interventions the Warren campaign made that was critical, both before we came on and then during when we came on. You know, her ability to also openly evolve around policies dealing with criminal justice while we were on the campaign, evolve around her policies in foreign policy. We think that is a really a model for how movement or organizations and outside organizations could collaborate and exhibit open co-governance and accountability with the campaign. Now, given that Warren has stepped out of the race and we endorsed Bernie Sanders, and one of the things that we did following Warren leaving the race was to organize Warren supporters to engage with the Sanders campaign and endorse Bernie and work for Bernie to advance the change that Warren laid out. Because our opening premise was that we have two progressive candidates, and having both of them in the race presents opportunities for multiple on-ramps to the structural change that all of us are committed to. And that movement organizations have a higher prerogative that is outside any candidate campaign or one election or one candidate. And it's actually a good and healthy thing for progressives and folks in left movements to endorse multiple candidates, but to have the same movement prerogatives. And we think we exhibited some of that. We learned. We think there's a lot of learning still to be done. But, you know, we always understood that as the field would narrow, one of the candidates would leave, and it would be the work of whoever was on one side to organize the followers of the other in order to join the campaign. And that's what we've done with the Bernie Sanders campaign.
Great. Thanks, Mo.
Sure.
Is Rachel, if Rachel's back, I'd love to, you know, pivot back to Florida, since that also happened last night, and kind of hear, I know that you, like Rishi said, had actually tried to get some changes in the election as it happened. Can you speak to that and what's going on?
Yeah, can y'all hear me? Okay, great. Yeah, well, thank you again for having me. It's really an honor to be on the panel with so many incredible organizers. But yeah, I mean, we always knew as an organization that endorsed Bernie Sanders that it was going to be an uphill battle in Florida. Florida is you know, after two major Super Tuesday fights, many of the only campaign that actually ever really had infrastructure in Florida was the Warren campaign, because I think other campaigns were prioritizing earlier states and then we're going to pivot to Florida. And white, when they went to pivot to Florida, the corona outbreak happened. So any campaign activity actually the week before the election pretty much all got canceled and got moved to the phones. So Dream Defenders was actually the only real organization that was on the ground, in addition to local DSA chapters that were organizing around a Bernie Sanders presidency. And you know, we were up against a lot too, because our Democratic Party had very early on endorsed Biden, and many of our Democratic leaders had come out and stayed with Biden even after he did poorly in the, you know, in the early states. And so we were always knew we were up against a lot, and then Corona hit, and you know, we moved all of our operations to the phones, and as we got on the phones and talked to people, we knew it was going to be an uphill battle to get people to turn out on election day. You know, we talked to a lot of people who said that they were worried about getting sick, so didn't want to go out and potentially contract something. They were also people who were sick and felt this tension between, I want to vote, but I don't want to get others sick. And so when I got to my polling site on election day and it was completely empty, my polling site, which usually has a line around the corner, it was really disappointing, but also we kind of knew that was coming as we were on the phones and hearing these stories from people all across the state. And as people were getting really conflicting information, I mean, the CDC is telling you stay home, and then our governor was pretty much acting like it was business as usual, and that, you know, wasn't taking any measures, or wasn't even willing to entertain a conversation around taking measures to ensure that people had access to the ballot. We did work with Advancement Project to try a legal strategy. So we sent a demand letter to the governor on Friday night and then filed a lawsuit on Monday around basically a few of our members who, because Florida schools basically shut down on Thursday, those students who are registered to vote in the county where their school is, basically when they went home to their county where their parents lived or out of the state, because in Florida you can only vote at the polling site that you're registered in, they basically, because they weren't in the county where their school was, were no longer eligible or had access to the ballot. So we did a lawsuit around that, but the courts basically came back to us and said, well, voting already started, so we don't want to interrupt anything. You all can have people contact their supervisors of elections offices, and because it's an emergency, you can request that a ballot be re-delivered. So then we got on the phones, and when we were talking to people who were scared about voting or who were students who weren't in their home in the county where they were registered, and told them what the governor was saying around getting a ballot delivered, we basically started having people request ballots to be delivered. And then the SOE offices, when people called and requested that, basically laughed in people's faces. So we are like back in the courts because basically the ballots aren't getting delivered as was promised. And our real goal is how do we ensure that as we head into August, we really have a plan to ensure that there is much more wider access to vote by mail, you know, automatic voter registration, things that ensure that people are able to vote. Because, you know, unfortunately, we just saw a situation where people really had to choose between their personal safety and voting. There's lots of data out there, and we're still trying to analyze the data that's saying voter turnout was up in Florida. The raw number was up, but based on the population change, actually voter turnout was down, and day of voter turnout was down by a lot. And so, yeah, we're still trying to get clear on exactly what the data says and looking at all the exit polls around, you know, how Bernie fell with different demographics. But overall, I think Election Day was just, I think me going to my polling site and it being completely empty was just a sign of just the moment we're in. And I think we're really looking ahead to think about, you know, if Corona is still, if people are still quarantined for the next 6 months, really what does it mean for voting and for this election? And are really trying to recalibrate as organizers, kind of in an existential crisis moment around what it means for our work.
Yeah, it's basically the election's a shit show at this point, it seems. And it's unfortunate, it's sad that this, you know, may be, you know, may have been Bernie's kind of last stand in terms of, you know, primaries. We'll see. Natalia, what do you think? Like, how did you see this last round of elections play out? And what do you think the race is looking like? What, where do we go from here? Or do you want to add anything to what Rachel said?
Yeah, no, I think Rachel is definitely the resident expert on all things Florida. So I will let the expert speak. I think, you know, last night was what we knew was sort of coming. Did it make it any less difficult to have to see? I feel like, you know, some of the things that I am walking away with from this election cycle is a conversation around, can you guys still hear me okay?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, great. The sort of things that I'm walking away with from this primary cycle is, you know, we have always talked as a movement about the Deep South, about the numbers that exist in the Deep South and how the demographics are in our favor, right? The sort of Black communities that are there, the numbers of Black voters that exist in some of those states, the Latino community that is growing there. And we have always talked about the Deep South as sort of being the next frontier, the next place where the movement's really going to build and really sort of push to make an investment in. And I think what this has shown to me, and I think to others, is like, that time is now. I think the investment into the Deep South needs to start now. We need to be talking to voters in Alabama, in Mississippi, in Tennessee, and we really need to have a conversation about what does it look like to share that ideology apart from the people we're comfortable talking to, the people on each coast and some in the Midwest. What does it look like to go into the South and have a culturally competent conversation with folks there, knowing what the legacy is there? And then I think, you know, moving forward, there is something to be said. As much as dismayed as I am, and the moment, with the pandemic and everything that is happening, it's easy to sort of like propel yourself into a negative space. But I also take a step back and I say to myself, when in my wildest dreams would I have thought that a democratic socialist was going to be seen as one of the front runners for the Democratic presidential nominee? And so I think there's something important to take in that, right? Like, there are lessons to be learned from the failures, but also let's take stock of where we have won. And the fact that we were talking about someone like that as a viable candidate for the Democratic nominee for president is a big deal. And I do think that we have always known that our movement would never be won through one election cycle. We have always known that it's going to take multiple election cycles to really sort of move and propel ourselves forward. And I think, this was a really good go at it. And I think the fact that we're talking about Medicare for all, I think the fact that we're talking about tuition-free colleges, I mean, all of those things really speak to the work that we've been able to do. And the fact that those issues are proving to be everything and are going to follow people into the general is a big effing deal.
Yeah. That's great, Natalia. Thank you. And this is a related theme. Marisa, I want to come back to you. Many left organizers for a long time have really concerned themselves with organizing around Black Brown unity for decades. A lot has been made of the issue of Black Brown unity in this race, with some people arguing that Bernie's sort of more progressive campaign enjoyed support from Latinx voters, and Biden's conservative campaign enjoyed support from Black voters, and that this sort of reflects a deeper tension between Black and Latinx voters generally. What's wrong or what's missing in that view? If there are differences in tensions, how do we understand them?
It's bullshit. it's just not okay. I think that, one of the things we talk about inside of Mijente is it's very important to understand the specificity of experience and the ways that oppression manifests and how it impacts different communities. You cannot compare how, in particular, I would say African-American folks in the South relate to voting to Latinos in, I would say, let's just say for the Southwest. There is a very different relationship. There is a very different approach. And I think it's like, you can't name like this idea that Black voters or the Black community is conservative. One, it's not a monolith, but that it is in fact conservative, it boggles the mind, because most progressive advancement, most advancement for the most oppressed has come through the efforts of Black people coming together and fighting for it. And rather than coming with some, half-ass analysis like that, we should frankly be saying thank you. With respect to Black voters in the South, I think that in many ways we can understand that as harm reduction. It is a tactic. It is a very practical decision. When you look at what Black voters' perspective is, what their support is of Donald Trump, it's higher than Latinos. And so Black voters are very much, what I would guess, is looking to see, well, what's the best chance we have to get this person out? And secondly, Black voters are going to look and see, well, what are the white people going to do? Because I just think if you're talking about a platform of Medicare for all, raising the minimum wage, eliminating student debt, a Green New Deal, that is not something that wouldn't positively impact Black folks. Of course it would. I think what people are asking, and I would imagine they're asking, is, but are the white people going to go for it? And so that is not to depict that as conservative. To depict that as ignorant, I think, is the height of stupidity, just to say. And so with respect to Latinos, it's a very different question. Latinos, the mythology inside of the Latino community says, bow your head, keep working, don't ask questions, and things will be better. And the reality, I think, that people are seeing, and I think it's a painful one, but an opportunity, is that that's not true. That is not always true. And under this administration, it has especially not been true. And so Latinos, I think, when it comes to voting, are, what does it matter? I don't see that necessarily changing. I can smell bullshit a mile away. When people are coming from their home countries, they understand corruption. They understand the government that doesn't, the governments that might not be willing to serve the people. And so people are saying, well, why should I vote? And so then the community sort of defined or depicted as apathetic, when in fact it's actually desirous of authenticity and a platform that actually speaks to people. And so Latinos were responding to Bernie, I think, I think it's three basic reasons: because the Bernie campaign prioritized reaching out to the community because the platform spoke to the community and spoke to the realities of the community. And third, because of the consistency of his message, I think cut through people's, you know, apathy. These are really different experiences, different perspectives. I think it's just very simplistic and not helpful to then say, you know, black and brown voters are at odds here. It's just much more complicated than that. And so the task at hand now is, you know, how do we take advantage of this opportunity? How do we take advantage of the fact that millions of people responded to this platform? Thousands of people donated, thousands of people volunteered, and how do we build organizing muscle in the Latino community coming out of this campaign?
That's great, Marisa. And, oh, go ahead.
I also, you know, when you take like very sort of local examples, you have TAP and the work that they did in Harris County. And it was over the course of 8 electoral cycles, going into the communities there and talking to Latino and Black folk, not about the candidates, about the issues they cared about. And really sort of building that rapport with them that didn't just come once every 4 years or once every 2 years the way the Democratic Party has done. They sat down, they built with these folks hand in hand, and they partnered up with these communities. And so I think that is really true to Marisa's point about apathy. It's just folks have never really understood in a culturally competent way, how to talk to Black voters and how to talk to Latino voters in a way that really speaks to where we have been and where we're coming from. And I think that when we look at some of the local organizing, we know that deep and personal actually works, and that not leading with problematic ass candidates is usually a better path, and leading with the issue definitely leads to riper fruit.
That's great, Natalia. Yeah, thanks. There's a related question I want to just toss to Mo, because, you know, part of this, obviously, in terms of understanding people's existing political relationships and their existing context, is understanding, for better or worse, people's long-term relationship or long-term voting history, in any case, with the Democratic Party. And, you know, Working Families Party, you've talked sort of explicitly about the Working Families Party being, you know, a new party alternative for social movements and the communities that we organize in. Can you talk a bit about sort of, you know, how's that going? Or, you know, how have we used this race to build our independent political power and independent political organizations so far?
Sure, thanks. Well, you know, the Working Families Party is a political movement and a strategy to build and to capture and build upon independent political power outside of the two-party system, both the Democrats and the Republicans. And, you know, we recognize that we have a very entrenched two-party system, right? So we're very nimble, which means we endorse and we use the Democratic primary as a site of struggle, even as we're building our own independent power. You know, I think in this particular race, we saw how our endorsement was an intervention, and we think being an outside independent group, we signaled to many others, some of which went the other way, some of which endorsed Bernie and not Warren, but we signaled to many others building independent power and many other outside groups that it was appropriate to endorse, and to endorse as readily as one could on an aggressive timeline, because time is one of the resources that once we lose, we never regain. The other thing I would say is, during this cycle, one of the things that we were able to leverage was the endorsement of both Bernie and Elizabeth Warren on down ballot races. So, you know, Kendra Brooks was endorsed by Elizabeth Warren. She was an independent, local, third party Working Families candidate in Philadelphia City Council. She ran and built a coalition that included Bernie supporters, Warren supporters, labor unions, and other folks in Philadelphia. She won as an independent third-party Working Families person. And so we had a Democrat endorsing a third-party Working Families candidate who was an independent working-class Black woman organizer in a municipal race. And so that's a model of leveraging presidential politics and bringing it down to the ground where there's coalitions and there's forces emerging on the left that are coming together in an electoral united front and winning in an independent way outside of the Democratic Party. And now Kendra Brooks is sitting in the Philadelphia City Council and leveraging that muscle outside of the Democratic Party and Republican Party. And both the Republicans and Democrats worked their hardest to oppose Kendra. And now, you know, we have independent real estate in the city council aided by the presidential politics. What we've seen, and Kendra's just one example, we saw a number of examples of Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren endorsing independent, insurgent, down ballot candidates and bringing to bear their platforms and their notoriety and their followers to nationalize many of these races. And that energy was helpful in lifting up independent third party politics and sort of like modeling the fusion and the tension between working within the two party system, using the Democratic primary as a site of struggle while retaining independence and building upon the independent infrastructure that we're trying to build as an independent party.
That's great, Mo. Thanks.
Sure.
What do you think, Rachel? You all endorsed most of these organizations. Probably this was their first endorsement of presidential candidate. What do you all think that you've gotten out of it? Or if you want to answer any of the thing that was the conversation before about kind of black, brown unity, what are you thinking about?
Yeah. I mean, I think our membership voted to endorse, make a presidential endorsement, and then voted to endorse Bernie Sanders. I think because we saw an opportunity to grow our base and to engage people around a socialist agenda. And I think sort of lost in the conversation around black voters is the fact that both in 2016 and in 2020, Sanders actually has won over black people, I think, under the age of 40. And I think that is a real sign of like the sort of generational divide that I think exists in all communities. And the fact that I think young people in particular right now, given the fact that we have $1.7 trillion in student debt, given the fact that just all the things that we're up against, that we are really ready for like a radical new vision for the future of the country. And I think Bernie Sanders' vision really spoke to people. And so I think the opportunity to have our organizers across the state use the election to talk to young people about building political power, to talk to young people about this radical vision, and then to organize young people around this idea of like vote and then we're rebelling. Like, I think young people have been sold a message many times that like just voting will solve your problems. And I think what was inspiring to us about Bernie Sanders' message is that Bernie never said voting is the answer. He said, hey, vote. And then once I get into office, you all need to turn up on me and the rest of Congress in order to ensure that we're actually able to follow through on an agenda. And I think that sort of power analysis, that sort of like organizer-in-chief strategy, I think that message really resonated with our base and our membership. And they liked talking to young people that have been, I think, really disillusioned by the Democratic establishment and politics as usual. That was a really like exciting, engaging message. And so I think like, you know, headed into like, you know, potentially Bernie Sanders, a Biden candidacy, I think we are really just trying to figure out how we pivot all the energy that we had around Bernie towards turning up on Biden to ensure that he is actually forced to adopt Sanders' agenda. And I think, you know, thinking about this particular moment around Corona, I think it's actually a huge opening to put forth really radical demands around universal basic income and moratorium on evictions and Medicare for all. And so we're really excited to actually like make Biden an SDR. You know, I think a lot of people talk about Roosevelt and the New Deal, like he just wanted to do those things, but there was actually like mass movements happening all over the country, strikes, occupation of Washington, D.C. that really like led to him adopting the New Deal. And so I think we're like interested in how we pivot all the energy and the organizing energy we had around Sanders and getting folks to vote in the primary to now turn up on Biden to make him a Roosevelt president and, you know, force him to really adopt a radical set of demands that young people are excited about right now.
Yeah, that's great, Rachel. You know, we have two, there's like two big things that we haven't really tackled yet. And they're like our big threats of the moment. And on the one hand, there's sort of coronavirus, which we've talked about a bit. And the other is Trump and the sort of right and the right wing movement behind him. So, you know, I want to talk about Trump for a minute. And Marisa, we'll start with you. But again, others should feel free to jump in. But recently on, you know, my fellow editor at Organizing Upgrade, Max Elbaum, argued in an article recently that Trump is poised to further consolidate his strongman presidency as we move forward. And even though it's not exactly the fascism of the last century, the danger that it poses is more or less the same. Marisa, what's your view of sort of the threat of the right and Trump and the right-wing movement in this period?
As red as real, I think that we have to be prepared for. I mean, I'll say this: I think what Trump has done so successfully is that he has really taken some things that are real and true in this moment. The level of resentment, the level of the inequalities that are growing. Things that I think probably points of analysis that maybe some of us would agree with at different points, but his articulation as to why it's happening, who's to blame and what the solution is, obviously completely contrary. And that to me is the greatest thing I worry about when I think about the general election, that the Democratic Party come with this, you know, similar to 2016 saying, you know, America's already great again, we're good. You know, what he's saying is untrue, or what he's proposing is you know, it's not going to work. And that I think was a big part to me what was so refreshing and important about the Sanders campaign and Bernie Sanders' platform. Trump's narrative, Trump's ability to manage and basically organize the media, and the forces that have fallen, you know, behind him, I think have been, you know, in addition to like just things about his campaign in terms of the management of data, the money it has, you know, and at the same time, we could still win. What I worry about is that we haven't shown the level of, as a progressive movement, we haven't shown the ability to unite. We haven't shown the ability to actually have a clear division of labor between groups and what role they're playing. And I think that is very critical for the progressive movement to do right now. We need to take a really sober look at what happened in these primaries, assess, and be able to move and have different people play their roles. You know, not only to ensure the best possible result in November of this year, but also to grow from this experience and be able to build from it.
Yeah, that's great. Anybody else?
Yeah, I would just agree with that. This is actually an opportunity, sort of, the experience from the primary, as well as the overlapping crises that we're all responding to. This is an opportunity for us on the left to align and to have some real talk about the next few months and the next few years. And what is it that we could only do together that would be the most effective intervention on our politics? And, you know, just speaking to I think the threat is clear of Trump's authoritarianism, but also like the international scope of it, the fact that Trump is one of a number of authoritarians that in the past few years have risen all throughout the world. And, you know, Bolsonaro in Brazil, Orban in Hungary, Salvini in Italy, you know, on and on, the Saudis, the far right of Israel, and they all both have risen in this moment and are coordinating and collaborating. So the importance of us defeating Trump is not just a parochial concern of movements in the United States. It's actually a global concern if we're able to tackle one of these authoritarians and the one that is currently occupying the White House, that would have a significant global impact. And I don't think we should understate the impact of doing that. I agree it will be challenging. And I think a Biden nomination would make it more challenging for us. But I am not one to sort of engage in sort of conversations that result in cynicism or despair. There are possibilities if we take the opportunity to align our forces and then determine the greatest purpose that we only could do collectively. And I think there's a number of interventions we can make. And I think there's work that only we could do on the ground. And we're best positioned to have conversations, credible conversations with our folks about the stakes. I also agree that the centrist neoliberal logic doesn't work, and certainly doesn't work in this moment. And I think we're observing that when the market is collapsing, when we're undergoing a global pandemic and also a political crisis that's global, both the far-right logic and the neoliberal logic is incompatible in terms of like the scale needed and the remedies needed. We're uniquely positioned. We're uniquely positioned to intervene because we do have solutions that both are practical and scale to the crisis of the moment. It's just a question of whether or not we could align our forces. And we've had trouble doing that, not just in this cycle, but that has been a limitation of our movements for quite some time.
I think that, you know, the guests on this call are pretty committed to figuring that out, how to unite, you know, the different sections of the movement at this time. Does anyone want to talk to that? Or I want to ask just how we're going to do this in the age of the coronavirus, but give a second if anybody wants to add to Maurice's comment.
Yeah, I just wanted to add one quick thing. Just, I think this moment underlies the importance of, like, I think the question earlier about solidarity between Black and immigrant communities, because I think what I'm very scared about and what seems like what could likely happen is that Trump is going to adopt some of our socialist demands. And I think, you know, Trump's nationalist border wall, like, you know, anti-immigrant rhetoric, I think there's like the potential of it being adopted by African-American communities. And when like Trump is, you know, and like, especially in the face of a Biden opponent who like, you know, authored the 94 crime bill and the war on drugs, I think it's actually like a pretty logical argument that Trump's like, I'm doing more for your community than Biden ever did. And so I think actually solidarity is really imperative right now to making sure that Trump is not elected again, and getting people to see, like, you know, I think Trump has been making all sorts of overtures to Black people. And part of his calculation is that if he's able to just, you know, chip away at like 5 to 10% of Black voters, that he'll have it in the bag. And like, he's actually invested more money into talking to Black voters through like radio and online ads in Florida than the Democratic Party has. And so I think like a really visible united front between Black and immigrant communities is like more important than ever. And to like build off of, I think, the class solidarity that was really the foundation of the Sanders campaign.
Natalia, what do you think? Do you think we can build this kind of solidarity even in a time where folks can't get, you know, go door to door? I know you were saying, or you've been doing a lot of research and just looking into kind of what some of the impediments are or what groups on the ground are doing now that they can't go door to door. How can we kind of build this even in such a challenging environment?
Yeah, I mean, I think the advantage that we have is the digital work acting as the connective tissue to us and our networks, right? And sort of really sort of focusing in on that. Whereas before it was the sort of supplemental thing to the door-to-door conversations, it's now going to have to really act if we're not able to get this pandemic under control as the sort of main vehicle for communication. Luckily for us, we have a major group of people that we're going to have to engage in the general election who are very young, very technologically savvy, and are going to be open to these types of communication. So I think that we're going to have to get creative in ways that we maybe haven't had to before. But I think the sort of leaning into the sort of relational organizing, which me and the rest of the probably Gen Xers would just call regular organizing, we're really going to have to just sort of like figure that out and lean into that and really get creative with that. I know there's all sorts of things that are happening around narrative setting. You know, you have Push Black, you have the Pulsos that are really sort of coming up and helping to set the tone and the content and the story that is really sort of uniting our communities. And then you have all the other sort of relational apps that we really need to dig in on and really do some quality control to just ensure that we're leaning into the right ones. But I really think that we're coming into a time when digital is going to play a role that maybe it has played a more sort of backup role, and now it's going to be front and center.
Yeah, just building off that, over the weekend when all of our organizers had canvases planned and parties to the polls planned, and then we had to switch it all to the phones, it was really hard because basically all of our organizers had to sit in a room by themselves all day for like 12 hours and, you know, go through the dialer. And I think it was a real moment for me where I was like, you know, we had to think creatively about how do we create community online for our organizers while they're like sitting on the phones alone in a room all day making calls. And so finding creative ways to bring people together through Zoom. Hey, we're going to take a break and I'll play an Uno game over Zoom. We're going to take a break and do yoga together on Zoom. Like, I actually think there's a real opportunity right now to think creatively about how we create community and potentially reach a much wider audience than we could reach just in for like face-to-face organizing. And like particularly thinking about how much the right has actually invested in an online organizing young people. I think the left has like kind of let the right like usurp the internet and the digital realm in many ways. And so I'm really excited for us to like stake some claim on the internet, particularly in this moment when like, you know, all of the schools in Florida right now are shut down and they've moved to like online classes. And I think with people in this moment of social distancing are actually going to be really yearning for ways to find community online. And so I'm really excited for us to actually like stake claim on that and bring people into the movement who might not otherwise find themselves in the movement in this moment when so much is at stake and people are really looking for a community to be a part of.
Thanks, Rachel. Y'all, we unearthed a lot of content, and obviously, you know, questions are hard to resolve in this period because so many conditions are unfolding. But we're gonna stay on top of this. I know everybody, all of our participants, and hopefully everybody in the audience is still hustling on the ground. We're gonna wrap here. I want to give a huge thank you, lots of gratitude to all four of our panelists, and a huge shout out to all the folks who joined in and listened in the audience. Our next show, the third episode of This Is Not a Drill Live, is going to be on April 8th, 5 p.m. Pacific and 8 p.m. Eastern, just like this call was. We're going to have another excellent group of panelists. If you have not already, please check us out at organizingupgrade.com. You can subscribe and join our newsletter. Make sure to check out the folks at Real News also. And this was our first episode partnering with our friends at Real News. There was a couple technical glitches, so hopefully people made it through the episode, but we'll have all that ironed out for next time. But thank you very much. Adam, you want to close us out?
No, just thanks, everyone. Make sure and participate in Zoom yoga with Dream Defenders. And this is a time we all need to take care of each other, for sure. So do that in your organizations, do that with each other. That's the only way we're going to turn these really tough times into a transformative moment, which I think we are all working towards. So thanks for joining. Good night. We'll see you next time.
Good night, everyone.